In May 2001, I was attending my second Electronic Entertainment Exposition at the Los Angeles Convention Center. I didn't have a hotel, nor could I afford one at the time, but my friend and I didn't care. We were gamers. We wanted to see what the next year of video games had in store for us, and we were willing to do anything to make that happen, even sleeping in his 2000 Hyundai Accent on the city streets in Chinatown. We really wanted to see the Nintendo GameCube on display before its fall 2001 release, and quite frankly, so did everybody else at the show. The line was long, in fact it was too long, so we opted to cruise over to the other hall to see what was happening on the PC gaming side of things. It was here that we stumbled into a small booth in the back corner of the hall, a no-frills setup that didn't have the shine or polish of Nintendo or Sony across the way. And this rather unsuspecting booth was featuring a new console that was also releasing in the fall, the Xbox. Microsoft had their flagship console on display with a few games ready to test. One of those games was a new first-person shooter about an intrepid space marine marooned on a ring-like planet and fighting Earth's greatest foe. The developers from Bungie ushered my friend and I over to a small pod of Xbox dev kits connected via LAN for a four-player game of Capture the Flag on a map set in a canyon with a concrete base on either side. Only later would I learn that this map was titled Blood Gulch. I fell in love immediately, and nearly 20 years later, I still love the adventures of Master Chief, Cortana, and the adventure of battling the Covenant on the Ringworld Halo. Microsoft and Bungie knew what they had on their hands when the video game launched alongside the Xbox in the fall of 2001. And through positive word of mouth and LAN-based multiplayer events, the popularity of Halo only grew. Hell, after I introduced it to my friends and bullied them into buying the $400 console for the game, it's what we all would play. Some of my favorite moments are going over to my friend's house and playing split-screen for hours while we chain-smoked and drank our 2 liters of soda deep into the night. Sure, it wasn't healthy, and we didn't care. It was Halo. And while those parties faded away once Halo 2's online multiplayer became a thing, our love for the game kept us going time and time again. To this day, some of my favorite moments from my youth are based around the Halo franchise. And one thing I've always wanted to see was Spartan 117 on the big screen. To see him fight, fly, drive, and blast his way through endless waves of the Flood in order to stop the universe from being overtaken. I wanted a Halo movie. And we almost got one once. This is actually that story. Going back, the first public mention of a Halo movie adaptation was reported in Variety all the way back in February 2005. This was only a few months after the release of Halo 2, and clearly Microsoft wanted to capitalize on the popularity of the hit sequel. The Variety article, simply titled Halo Hollywood, Microsoft Ready's Vid Game for First Pick, it went on to explain that the software publisher had hired Alex Garland to adapt the sci-fi game in a multi-million dollar deal. If you don't know who Alex Garland is, you should really dive into his library of work. He wrote 28 Days Later, the book that the film The Beach was based off of, Sunshine, Ex Machina, and of course the absolute fan favorite, 2012's Dread. In nerd culture, this dude is known and pretty well liked. So when news first broke that he was working on the screenplay, I was very excited because 28 Days Later is one of my favorite movies. And with Garland on board, I figured that the Halo movie would be a violent, bloody, and oh-so-satisfying experience. Apparently, so did Microsoft because they ended up paying him a whopping $1 million up front just to write the spec script. Microsoft's plans to get this script made into a movie was a very odd one, and it's still very odd for Hollywood. They wanted to oversee the script, make it perfect, and then sell it as a turnkey to a studio. This meant that it was the entire deal. It was a sale for the script and the rights packages. If I had to guess, Microsoft saw the Halo movie very similar to how Hasbro saw Transformers back in the 1980s. Hasbro created the Transformers TV show in order to sell toys. Microsoft wanted to make the Halo movie in order to sell more consoles and copies of the game. Makes sense, right? Now, going back to the Variety article, the reason for this particular move was this strategy, insiders say, is the handiwork of ex-Columbia Pictures president Peter Schlesel, who left the studio to become a producer just over 2 years ago. He's expected to serve as a producer in some capacity on the Halo film. Now, Peter Schlesel is a name you probably don't recognize at all. In fact, his IMDb doesn't really start to pick up until about 2010. So if that's all you were going to go on, you would think that this guy was a nobody who was able to talk Microsoft into this really weird, crazy deal. It turns out this guy is actually way more experienced than most of us realized. In fact, this is what his biography says, and it's pretty impressive. Schlesel began his career in entertainment in 1989 as a director of legal affairs for the RCA/Columbia Home Video. In 1996, he co-founded Screen Gems, a division of Sony Pictures Entertainment, which financed and produced mid-range budgeted pictures. During his tenure at SPE, he supervised more than 1,500 third-party acquisitions. Under Schlesel's leadership, revenue grew tenfold for the acquisition and co-production lines of business. In 2000, Schlesel was promoted to president of production for Sony Pictures Entertainment's Columbia Pictures. In 3 years as president of production, Columbia's box office rank rose from number 8 in 2000 to number 1 in 2002, setting a then industry record of $1.57 billion. This is mostly because of the success of the original Spider-Man movie. In the beginning of 2003, Schlesel was promoted to president of Columbia Pictures and was involved in the studio's summer hits like Spider-Man, Charlie's Angels, and SWAT. Internationally, he spearheaded Columbia's acquisitions of Terminator 3, Rise of the Machines, and Terminator Salvation. This guy knows his shit, and actually worked really well for Sony. And on a side note, he probably should get courted by Sony again, because they need it. Anyway, Peter Schlesel took a 3-year sabbatical from Sony in 2004, and it was during this time that he teamed up with Microsoft for the Halo movie. I can only assume that Peter wanted to work with Microsoft on this project because of how profitable the Halo franchise was leading into the release of Halo 2. According to that same Variety report from 2005, they said this: "The Halo franchise is one of the most popular in video game history, having sold over 12.8 million units and grossed approximately $600 million since its 2001 debut. Last year, Halo 2 sold 6.4 million copies and was the second best-selling video game of the year. Halo is largely credited with making Xbox the hottest game console among hardcore gamers who love its intense multiplayer action. Speculation whether and how Halo would make its way onto movie screens has been flying around Hollywood and the video game world for years, as nearly every producer in town expressed interest in the title. It became clear that Microsoft wasn't interested in licensing it out of fear that a poorly received adaptation, similar to Final Fantasy or Super Mario Bros., could hurt the lucrative franchise." Now, the subject of past video game movies always seems to come up when discussing new video game movies. I mean, it makes sense, even though the video game franchises tend to mean little in regards to the success of another, but Hollywood doesn't look at gaming success in the same way. Or at least they didn't in 2005. The 1993 Super Mario Bros. Movie was a failure, sure, but it's loved by millions of fans around the world now. And that was followed up by 1995's Mortal Kombat, which was successful and is still loved 25 years later. Now, the mention of Final Fantasy: The Spirits Within was an interesting one for me. The Final Fantasy series is nothing like Halo. They might share some overlap in regards to their fan base, but when it comes to the general population, there's quite frankly no comparison. They are just too different. However, Final Fantasy: The Spirits Within had a production budget of $137 million, and this is in the early 2000s, mind you, and it only took home $87 million worldwide. You can see why there would be apprehension from the studios over a project like this, but this was Halo, a franchise that was just over 3 years old and had sold 12.8 million copies, earned over $500 million in sales, and far more now. This could easily translate to a very successful movie if it was made well. It didn't even have to be great. It just had to be good. Hell, passable would be okay enough to rake in millions in profit. If it was great, it could have been a billion-dollar movie before there were billion-dollar movies. Yes, I believe this. Now, 4 months later after the article, on June 6, 2005, this happened. And this is an excerpt from the book Generation Xbox, How Video Games Invaded Hollywood, that describes just how Peter Schlesser and Microsoft wanted to sell this video game adaptation to studios. It says, "The Master Chiefs left the offices of Creative Arts Agency around midday on June 6, 2005, in a fleet of limo vans. In their green, red, and blue Spartan armor, the cybernetically enhanced super soldiers made quite a spectacle. Each stood 6'3", visored helmets obscuring their faces. Each carried a red-bound document folder stamped with the CAA logo that contained two things: a copy of the Halo screenplay commissioned by Microsoft and written by Alex Garland, and a term sheet. None of them spoke a word. The security guards on the gates of the major motion picture studios are used to seeing many things. Still, a hulking soldier from the future striding towards them and demanding access to the studio's top brass was inevitably going to end in some kind of shooting incident, whether involving a United Nations Space Command BR-55 battle rifle or a security guard's arguably more deadly 38 revolver. Now imagine that. An army of Master Chiefs walking into the top Hollywood studios to drop off Alex Garland's script. It must have been an amazing sight to behold, and one hell of a splash, too. Now look, the team at CAA, they had called ahead to let the studios know of the plan, but it did come with a caveat. The studios were on a ticking clock to option the Halo film. In fact, they were only given a couple of hours to read the script and then decide if they wanted to agree to Microsoft terms before the Master Chief took the script back to the agency. This ballsy move was spearheaded by CAA's Larry Shapiro, who had actually lifted this concept off of the pitch for Roland Emmerich's The Day After Tomorrow. In that instance, the studio execs had 24 hours to read the script and decide. Here, they had mere hours. And because of that, Larry's plan was to get the trades to cover it, and in my personal opinion, use the public pressure to force their hands into the deal. And this was all before Microsoft's demands were known. And apparently, it almost worked. Microsoft wanted to aggressively market this film in Hollywood. This was a tech giant, arguably the biggest in the world at the time, and they wanted to swing their big dick through Tinseltown and get the respect that they felt they deserved. But they didn't get Hollywood, and their approach to business, which is usually very data-driven, came off as problematic for some of the studios. The Generation Xbox excerpt sums up Microsoft's plans pretty well. It says, "Peter Schlesser, the former president of production at Columbia Pictures, was one of the main negotiators in the Halo movie deal and served as Microsoft's Hollywood liaison. Together with Microsoft and its lawyers, Schlesser and the CAA team hammered out a term sheet. We were literally setting out to be the richest, most lucrative rights deal in history in Hollywood," says Shapiro. "You have to remember that no property, not even Harry Potter, was getting what we are asking for. Microsoft, a global software giant used to getting its own way, wasn't about to kowtow to Hollywood. It knew that Halo was the jewel of video game movies, the one that could be a true blockbuster hit." Now, according to Variety, Microsoft wanted $10 million against 15% of the box office gross, in addition to a $75 million below-the-line budget and fast-tracked productions. Those are insane terms. That's that big dick energy I was talking about before. Not only did Microsoft want all that money, but they also wanted all that control. They wanted creative control over who would star in the film and who would direct the film. They also wanted 60 first-class tickets for their employees to fly to LA for the world premiere. But they wouldn't put up any more money outside of the million that they had paid to Alex Garland for the spec script, nor would they sign over the merchandising rights. they were really putting the squeeze to the studios, and clearly Peter Schlesel and Larry Shapiro were not doing their job effectively to get the software developer to lower its expectations. But like I keep saying, big dick energy. Microsoft was essentially a bridezilla at this point, and I don't think there was anything anyone could do about it. One thing that was really funny about this whole promotional experiment is that Miramax got snubbed, and Harvey Weinstein was not happy. He apparently even called in to complain about getting left out. I mean, there was no way that Miramax would put up the budget for a Halo movie, but this was really all about prestige. Harvey just wanted to be included, and his ego was bruised as a result. Good. Fuck him. And here's actually another really funny thing. There was one huge player that was left out of the negotiations, Columbia Pictures. Why? Because Sony had purchased Columbia Pictures and Microsoft did not want to deal with the creator of their rival console, the PlayStation 2. Never say that the console wars were not a real thing. Now, not everyone was impressed with Microsoft's arrogance. Some actually said that the Halo franchise was too popular by then, so there wasn't any real urgency with the script deal. And the over-the-top theatrics were relatively unnecessary. To some extent, I actually agree with that. However, here it is, 16 years later, and I'm still talking about it like it was a cool fucking thing. Because it was. So, you know, take that for what you will. What Microsoft wasn't expecting, however, was two studios to team up and work together to get the movie made. Fox and Universal, however, came to an agreement and offered to partner up. Universal would oversee production of the film and handle the domestic distribution, and Fox would handle the international distribution. This absolutely fucked Microsoft. They wanted control, and now they had lost relatively all leverage power. But that big dick energy wasn't gone yet. And that wasn't a good thing. Not long after signing the deal with Fox and Universal, Peter Jackson had signed on to executive produce the film, and apparently he wasn't cheap. And Microsoft wasn't happy with this at first because they wanted him to direct the movie. Jackson, on the other hand, wanted to give the opportunity to his protege, Neil Blomkamp. Blomkamp at the time had only really produced a few short films like Alive in Joburg, which is a story about alien apartheid in South Africa, and ultimately the basis for the excellent District 9. The studio was apparently okay with Blomkamp because of Jackson's price tag, but Blomkamp, on the other hand, was scared shitless of being chewed up and spit out by the Hollywood production machine. He is even quoted as saying that this thing was a clusterfuck since day one, and that the two studios never saw eye to eye on anything. But in his mind, he says that he was genetically created to work on Halo. He loved the property and he wanted to make it awesome. But he quickly realized that Fox wanted something more boilerplate and generic. They didn't want his gritty, cyberpunk-esque violent film dominating the summer blockbuster scene. Neil Blomkamp is quoted as saying, "The suits weren't happy with the direction I was going. Thing is, though, I'd played Halo and I play video games. I'm that generation more than they are, and I know that my version of Halo would have been insanely cool. It was more fresh and potentially could have made more money than just a generic, boring film, something like G.I. Joe or some crap like that." Thing is, he isn't wrong. He truly understands the Halo franchise, and the fans knew he understood the Halo franchise. This was just another situation where the suits and the fans don't see eye to eye. In this case, Blomkamp mentioned one name in particular, Tom Rothman. At the time, Rothman was the head of Fox, and if you know anything about the troubled production of Wolverine Origins or the silencing of Deadpool, then you know how much Tom Rothman is hated in geek culture. It's good to know that Blomkamp is on our side with this one. Makes me love him even more. In fact, Blomkamp, in my opinion, fully faults Fox for the failing of the Halo movie, and vowed to never work with the studio again unless they paid him a fuckload of money and he had full creative control. But it wasn't just Fox to blame. Microsoft also wanted its say heard, and Blomkamp believes that they weren't too happy with what he was doing while developing the movie. But still, Universal forked out $12 million to develop the film, and even a bit of that went to paying Guillermo del Toro, who at one point was attached to direct it, before departing to go work on Hellboy the Golden Army. Even Alex Garland's script was rewritten by D.B. Weiss. Yeah, the same D.B. Weiss from Game of Thrones. But what caught me by surprise was Alex Garland talking about the script in 2012. He was interviewed by IGN about Dread and the subject of the Halo movie came up. He apparently had the same issues with Microsoft that the studios did. He says, "The script I wrote was basically the same as the first Halo game. It took an element from the ending of the second Halo game for the ending, and basically I sat down with the guys at Bungie and Microsoft and said what I would do was a very faithful adaptation. I had bits of imagery in my mind. A lot of them came from the game, but you could also relate that imagery to other things, like Starship Troopers or something like that. A less satirical version of Starship Troopers, but for me, it's a different kind of project. On something like Halo, I'm a writer for hire. They have a thing they want to do. I'm not bringing anything to the party, as it were. They are saying, we would like you to do this, and I'm trying to do it as well as I can. It's a completely different kind of project to Sunshine, or 28 Days Later, or Dread, or Never Let Me Go, because those things are essentially personal projects. I can't get sacked, put it that way. So the dynamic is different." A less satirical Starship Troopers, huh? Kind of odd, but I also kind of dig the idea. Anyway, back to the movie. Part of the price tag of getting Peter Jackson on board was also using Weta Workshop to develop real-life props for the film. We're talking battle rifles, warthogs, Mjolnir armor. These guys were bringing Halo to life. And when the Halo Landfall short films premiered in 2007, fans like myself lost our shit. The Halo Landfall shorts were designed to be a tester for not only Neil Blomkamp to show off his style, but to hype the release of Halo 3. In fact, the last short film debuted mere hours before the midnight release of Halo 3 in September 2007. Sadly though, a year before fans saw these short films and the release of Halo 3, the Halo movie was canceled. What happened was this. In October 2006, Universal was contractually obligated to pay fees to the filmmakers and Microsoft. But because of how the development was going slow and the film wasn't progressing as fast as they wanted it to, they demanded that the producers' fees be cut. Well, okay, let's back up a quick second. While it was Universal who was footing the bill, it was actually 20th Century Fox, i.e. Tom Rothman, who demanded the first look deals for Jackson and Company to be cut. Fox even went as far as to refuse to pay Universal anything, which they ultimately settled out of court, but still. Remember how Peter Jackson was getting paid to do this movie? And so he sat down with other producers, Bungie and Microsoft, and they ultimately decided to not agree to Universal's demands. And with that, the Halo movie was dead in the water. Jackson, to his credit, tried to get the project off the ground again. He went on record in late October 2007 that they were talking with other distributors to get the film out there. But that never happened. And sadly, it all just went away. On the bright side, we actually did get District 9 out of the deal, which I'm okay with. And what about Halo in live action? Has there been any success on that front to get Master Chief's story to the big screen? Sadly, no. But we have had a few live action Halo adaptations and some animated stuff come to the small screen. In 2012, there was the feature length Halo Forward Unto Dawn, which served as a tie-in for Halo 4. In 2014, Halo Nightfall was released as a miniseries that was actually produced by Ridley Scott exclusively for the Halo channel on Xbox. But I think it's available on home video now. And supposedly this year, in 2021, we're going to be getting a live-action Halo TV series on Showtime that will be about John 117 and his adventures with Cortana. It isn't the big budget movie that we all wanted, but in the world of streaming, we have seen that these projects have the ability to be grander and better than their big screen counterparts. I, for one, am excited for what we get next. But I mean, I am saddened that the story of the Halo movie ended the way that it did. The problem with this film was that there was just too many cooks in the kitchen that were unable to come together to get a finished product to the market. Microsoft was just too used to being the big dog in the room and didn't understand how Hollywood worked. Universal, to their credit, tried to get it all to work, and I applaud them for going as far as they did. And Fox? Yeah, well, fuck Tom Rothman for screwing up another potential film franchise. At least he's now Sony's problem. Karmic justice indeed. But I do hope that we one day get to see the story. And I hope that one day we get to see more big screen adaptations of video games because, quite frankly, they're the perfect fit. Many video games have become very much Hollywood produced over the years anyway, with their larger than life cinematics, and I think it'd be kind of cool to see them on the big screen. But what do you think about this? I want you guys to let me know your thoughts about this. You can let me know in the comment section here on YouTube, or if you're listening to the podcast, you can find me on Twitter at mjarbo. I'll talk to you guys later for the next episode of Podio Commentary. Thank you again for listening. Have yourself a great day, and peace out.